this on? We're going to start our second panel.
إذن سوف نبدأ الآن بالجلسة الثانية. المتحدث الثالث هو في طريقه إلينا، ولكننا سوف نبدأ إلى حين ينضم إلينا. أولا أود أن أشكركم لبقائكم معنا بعد الغناء، وأعتقد أن نقاشنا سوف يكون مثير الاهتمام. معنا السيد بيتر هارلينغ من سينابس، وبيتر عمل في مجموعة الأزمة الدولية لسنوات عديدة في قضايا سوريا والعراق، ومعنا أيضا السيد نوا بونسي وهو ضمن مجموعة الأزمة الدولية.
produces some of the best reports on the situation in Syria from within the group. Before we started, I wanted to just start with a small quote from a gentleman called Omar Aziz, who was, and not our friend Omar Aziz Hallaj, but another person called Omar Aziz, who was a 63-year-old and was described as a martyr and an anarchist. He was killed at the beginning of the, towards the beginning of the uprising. And he was the first person who conceived of the idea of local councils, at least tried to give them a sort of framework. And I thought, I was reading again the translation of the small paper that he produced at the time. And I thought I would read just two small quotes of it to sort of for us to remember the spirit of the local councils, and then a few more comments on the impact of external intervention on what has become the local councils, or what is left of them, as we heard this morning. He says, a revolution is an exceptional event that will alter the history of societies while changing humanity itself. It is a rupture in time and space where humans live between two periods, the period of power and the period of revolution. A revolution's victory, however, is ultimately achieving the independence of its time in order to move into a new era. For Omar Aziz, the establishment of these local councils was the tool through which revolutions can actually move into a new era. The way he saw the role of the local councils was, again, he says, the blending of life in a revolution is an inherent requirement for its continuation and its victory. It requires a socially flexible structure that is based on collaboration between the revolution and the daily lives of human. This form of structure will be called the local councils. So for him, the local councils were very much an important instrument that would bring together what he saw as two separate times, the time of a revolution, of uprisings, of change, and a time where there was a need to sustain daily lives. Now, this was in 2011. When we speak of local councils today and the role of local actors, as we heard in, by, you know, through some of the speeches this morning, there are quite a broad range of local actors, and they impact local councils in very different ways. We heard about how, for example, the relationship between the local councils and Kurdish authorities have impacted local councils to a great degree. The funding that has come to militarized entities has also impacted the way local councils are able to engage and actually, you know, sustain themselves. At the same time, we also heard about how UN and aid, Sam spoke about a little bit about the role of the UN and the load of aid infrastructure in undermining or facilitating the work of local councils. We also, what we didn't hear a lot about, for example, is the role of the MOC in the military operations center that is based in Amman, on the behavior of the local councils in the southern parts of Syria. And there are, you know, there has been quite a bit of discussion on the extent to which they've been able to influence actors on the ground in the southern parts of Syria. I mean, local councils did emerge at the end of the day to fill a gap that was meant to be, that was left there by the state. And they have been attacked by a broad range of actors, whether it's through the state by maintaining salaries, services, or by sieging areas, particularly cities where local councils were perhaps most effective, like Daraya or Douma, and Aleppo, we should not. But also in terms of bombardments. And then also the local councils have been undermined by the increasing power of other local actors and their foreign sponsors, their external sponsors. Today we're going to be hearing about, or on this panel, we're going to be hearing at least, we can be sure, of two different perspectives. We're going to start with Noah Bonsi, who's going to speak about the role of the U.S. And the prospects of local councils, but also the prospects for Syria in general, and what we can think about moving forward. You're about to correct me.
I wasn't.
Noah, why don't you start? Sorry, I forgot to introduce myself. I'm Maha Yahya, I'm the director of Carnegie Middle East Center.
Well, thanks so much, Maha and Khadr, for having us here at Carnegie. So I thought I would, I'm going to speak about the American role, and obviously there's a lot of ground that we could cover there. What I'm going to do is basically start with a couple of notes on how things might shift under a Trump administration, and then get into sort of what that will mean, two points about what that will mean for some of the local dynamics that were discussed in this morning's panel. So first, I mean, I think as probably most of you are by now well familiar with, it's very difficult to predict what Trump himself will do, let alone what his administration will do moving forward on a conflict as complicated as Syria. I'll make a couple points on why it's so difficult for us to predict that right now. I mean, one, there's the fact that Trump so often changes his own opinion on major issues. You're all familiar with that, I'm sure. We know he's been more skeptical about support for the opposition in Syria. We know he's generally uninterested, it would appear, in gaining a more granular knowledge of Syria or foreign policy in general. But we don't know if what positions he has articulated will shift. We also don't know how much in foreign policy in general, or Syria in particular, he'll be delegating to people beneath him, including his Secretary of State, Secretary of Defense, et cetera. And we don't know really who he'll trust on what he does delegate. And one of the reasons that makes things so difficult is when you look at the people he's appointed thus far, you have a real, you have a dramatic range in views on the U.S. role in the world and foreign policy towards the Middle East in general and Syria in particular. Will Trump rely on his own instincts and those of General Flynn, who he's appointed as his national security advisor, which generally are skeptical of the Syrian opposition? Trump himself has been very skeptical of the Syrian opposition. He and Flynn are very are skeptical of Islamists in particular. You have a lot of anti-Islamist sentiment within parts of the Trump camp that presumably would work against the opposition's favor. But on the other hand, Trump has just appointed as his, or is about to officially appoint as his Secretary of Defense, General Mattis, who is, contrary to Trump, a known skeptic of working with Russia, has been generally perceived as hawkish on Iran, and therefore, and both he as well as Mitt Romney, who may be named, we don't know, as Trump's Secretary of State, they've generally been within the foreign the mainstream of the U.S. foreign policy establishment, which has always supported a more robust American role in Syria in general, supporting the opposition and generally confronting Iranian and Russian influence in Syria as elsewhere. So when we look at this this sort of meshed of this spectrum of who is within the Trump administration and the unpredictability of the man himself, What are we left with? I mean, one, we have to be humble. I mean, it's just impossible to predict with any certainty. But I think the most likely outcome, to speculate just a bit, is that we're going to see an even narrower focus on the war against Daesh, against the Islamic State, which has been the one thing that Trump has been keen to talk about with regard to Syria. You know, he's talked in very violent and often scary language about that. But in general, he may be keen to demonstrate results on that. Already, the U.S. administration's focus has increasingly narrowed in on the war against IS. That's likely, I think that trend is more likely than not to continue under Trump. And parallel to that, I think we can expect less political investment, or let's put it this way, less U.S. investment in political outcomes in Syria. I would say it's a less than 50% chance that Trump would dramatically shift the U.S. position on the conflict itself. He's said some nice things about Russia, to be sure. He's expressed skepticism about the conflict against Bashar al-Assad and his regime. But at the end of the day, there are real costs to flipping the U.S. position, costs to the U.S. geostrategically, and costs to Trump personally. I think it's probably likely that he avoids flipping into another camp or changing the official U.S. position on the regime in any dramatic way, but more likely that he will just, that the American role will continue to recede, and it's already arguably been receding. So what are the ramifications of that if we just use that as a sort of working assumption of how the policy may end up? You know, I think one, U.S. influence on local dynamics, on local military dynamics, on local political dynamics, on everything that was discussed in the first panel today is likely to further decline. And I think it's useful to look at a couple examples of how U.S. leverage has already been limited, even under this current administration. You know, for instance, in Sam and Amar's presentations this morning, speaking about the local councils, there has been significant U.S. funding that's gone in their direction. Some of it, at least in theory, had a real strategy behind it, at least in the opening months. And yet, really, I mean, there have been such mixed results to that sort of stabilization funding, efforts to support political projects on the ground, primarily the local councils. The returns on the investment have been uneven. And the U.S. in general, it's got a very small number of people working on this issue set relative to its importance and its complications. And there, you know, the human resources deployed here are limited even to just cover the conflict analytically and figure out who they should be supporting, let alone to find means of exerting real leverage into how those receiving American support behave on the ground. That's true politically of the local councils. It's also true militarily of groups receiving support from the MOC and the MUM, armed rebel groups that have been vetted by the United States that receive support from the Joint Operations Room in which the United States is a member. The U.S. has played a major role in deciding who gets armed support, and that has to some extent helped non-jihadi groups, in particular the sort of, you know, from non-ideological and sort of lightly Islamist groups who have passed U.S. vetting. The U.S. role here has kept them on the map. In the South, it really, for a while, it was really increasing their role. In the North, it's helped keep them on the map. But even there, you know, the U.S. hasn't invested nearly enough and really lacks the direct leverage on the ground to be able to get these factions to do very much that it would like. You know, it certainly cannot separate them from Fatah al-Sham or Jabhat al-Nusra as the Russians have demanded and as the U.S. in theory would like to do. It can't even really get them to overlook, it can't get these local factions to overlook their own local competitions and personal competitions and coordinate more effectively, even just for their own sake, et cetera, et cetera. Had these factions been able to coordinate better amongst themselves, they might have, you know, the divide and conquer tactics we saw from Jabhat al-Nusra and Jindal Aqsa and some other jihadis might have proved less effective. But these factions were unable to defend themselves. The U.S. was unable to help them defend themselves more effectively. With the U.S. role declining and Trump has in particular expressed skepticism of this covert support. We can expect, we can expect that U.S. organizing role and the influence that comes with it to be even less important than it already is. Another example that I'll mention with regard to limits on U.S. leverage currently, and again, that's likely to further recede. Maria focused a lot on northeastern Syria this morning. The U.S. is providing very robust support to the PKK's Syria affiliate, the YPG. Air support, special forces support. It's providing arms that, yes, it's handing to the YPG's allies, but end up immediately in the hands of the YPG. All of this has given the YPG a lot of political legitimacy, unprecedented political legitimacy for the PKK. Despite all of that, all it has really gotten for the U.S. it has encouraged the YPG to focus more of their own efforts and resources against IS, against the Islamic State, including in areas outside that don't have a Kurdish majority or clear strategic value. So the U.S. has been able to get them to focus a bit more on that, and it's certainly improved their performance. But this U.S. role is not sufficient, or at least the way the U.S. is playing its cards, it hasn't been sufficient to even prevent the YPG in Afrin to the west from attacking groups that are rebel groups that are receiving U.S. support north of Aleppo, which happened repeatedly, has happened repeatedly in months past, and to some extent continues off and on. The U.S. can't even get the YPG not to attack its other allies, let alone can it impact the decisions that the YPG and its political leadership are making with regard to how this territory in the northeast and in Afrin is ruled. The U.S. has no influence whatsoever, basically, on how people in areas under YPG control are governed. It hasn't really attempted to use leverage on that, but if it tried, I think its ability to get results would be limited. So we take this already limited influence, and it's likely to further decline as the Trump administration invests even fewer resources towards these political ends. This is where I would set the stage for Malik, who, God willing, is going to walk in the door any minute and take it up. The second ramification that I wanted to highlight is what this decline, this likely receding U.S. role or shifting U.S. priorities means for the opposition and its regional backers. I mean, basically, already the opposition's fate, so much of it, I think we've overemphasized the U.S. role. I've been guilty of this myself a lot over the last few years, as Peter can tell you. But now more than ever, moving forward, the future of the opposition in Syria is in the hands of its regional backers, I think most importantly right now Turkey, and the armed groups themselves, and the coordination between these. And when we look at how things are going right now in northern Syria, we can see kind of two models, if you will, for how this might play out moving forward, a positive one and a negative one, or maybe positive and negative. From an opposition perspective, a positive one and a negative one. One I would highlight, Euphrates Shield. With Euphrates Shield, you have an example of Turkey, Euphrates Shield, of course, being the, we all know what Euphrates Shield is probably, the Turkish and rebel coordinated effort against the Islamic State and, to some extent, the YPG in northern Syria. We can get into more details about this in Q&A, but with Euphrates Shield, you have the Turks coming up with defining clear objectives, convincing rebel groups that they support to cooperate with them and among themselves toward these concrete objectives. And thus far, the military progress has been relatively effective militarily. Military challenges remain. Political challenges remain, governance challenges remain. But overall, it's been a relatively effective effort. And crucially, in addition to convincing its rebel allies to cooperate, Turkey was able to convince Russia that this project was not threatening to Russia's interests, and by extension, ultimately, not threatening to Iran and regime interests. The Russian sort of green light to the Turkish intervention was crucial in enabling it to happen in the first place and get as far as it went. Turkey defined these objectives, it built its alliance, it convinced the regime and its backers to that this was not threatening, and it's created favorable facts on the ground, facts that are favorable to Turkey and to the opposition. Contrast that with the situation in East Aleppo right now. Now, this is a complicated situation. This is complicated to some extent. The fact that Turkey has been successful in Euphrates Shield, I mean, clearly part of the quid pro quo with Moscow was stepping back from Aleppo. But to set aside that, the sort of deal-making dynamic there and just focus, I want to focus on the contrast between Euphrates Shield and what's happening in East Aleppo. In East Aleppo, Turkey, for the complicated reasons I just alluded to, has basically withdrawn its role from the East Aleppo situation. You know, support is still coming to the armed groups in the countryside, but Turkey is not playing an active role in helping the opposition respond to the pro-regime campaign on Aleppo. And meanwhile, the armed groups themselves, both inside the city and outside it, have not been effective at all in coming up with their own strategy to deal with the military escalation they face. Now, arguably, no matter how effective they were, this is, you know, this is a losing battle given the uneven balance of power here, or the imbalance of power. But even given the very difficult circumstances, the rebels have played their cards very poorly. Even as the regime offensive was really gaining steam, the rebels have been fighting each other within East Aleppo. As Turkey has withdrawn its hand, rebels have not only not overcome their continuing weakness in coordination, but have allowed their local competition, some of the local competition referred to in the panels this morning, they've allowed that local competition and the calculations regarding it to overwhelm the shared strategic objective of improving performance against the pro-regime campaign that they face. And the result has been rapid regime gains, at least initially, and we'll see what happens in the days moving forward. And I think that when we contrasting these two examples and looking ahead at what might come after Aleppo, if the pro-regime camp is able to take the eastern trunk of the city and does so with momentum going, Bashar Assad has already said that he wants to continue moving on to Idlib. If I were sitting in the opposition or in one of, or in Turkey or anywhere in that camp, I would be looking at, is Idlib going to follow East Aleppo's fate or the Euphrates Shield fate? I mean, obviously the circumstances in Idlib are more difficult than they have been for Turkey in the Euphrates Shield area, but in principle, the whole pro-opposition camp will be much better off to the extent that they're able to coordinate an effective response and engage in diplomacy with Russia to seek to minimize the pro-regime efforts against it. If they're able to do that, maybe they have a chance. If they aren't, and if Idlib goes the way that East Aleppo has, then the opposition's future is an asymmetrical insurgency in which they're controlling less and less territory and basically, staking what political hopes they may maintain on their ability to wear out the regime in a very long-term war of attrition. Which would be a dramatically different strategy than they've had to this point. So Malik is still not here, but hopefully he will pick, hopefully what Malik will speak to is a bit more on how the Turkey and other opposition backers have dealt with some of these challenges and dynamics. If he doesn't show up, Yani will figure it out.
We'll call on Peter.
I'll start with a caveat to Maha's presentation. Synapse is not a consultancy, a'udhu billah. What Synapse is very much a mystery, even to people who work for it. No, seriously, Synapse at this stage is primarily a fellowships program for young professionals in the region who are mentored to conduct the kind of granular field work which is relevant to a conference of this kind. So I came to represent this young organization, but soon enough, the fellows will be taking over and I will be watching this live from my couch. Speaking of which, I was in my couch when I got a tweet from Maha at 12:30 announcing that this panel was starting. So I had to rush out. I didn't even have time to retweet that, and got here an hour early. So this conference takes place in the post-factual world that Maha is contributing to, along with so many others. And my focus will be on the aid regime, the development sector in the relief sector in the context of this particularly tricky conflict. So I'll start with a paradox, which is that much of the aid regime has been driven by a desire to contain Syrians within Syria or within the vicinity of Syria. And at the same time, in its structure, this aid regime disempowers Syrians who want to stay to help other Syrians stay. And there are a number of reasons for that, which I'll come to. There are a number of reasons to explain any number of other failures in this conflict, but I think it's hard to find any good excuse when it comes to humanitarian aid and the development effort. I'll continue with another paradox, which is that this is arguably the best documented conflict ever so far. In terms of constant media coverage, and maybe it doesn't produce the effects that some would like it to, but the media coverage has been relentless for 5 years, and that's unusual by any prior standard. Syrians themselves have been extremely active, involved in the production of media products and information and analysis. And we've seen huge efforts on the part of the aid and development community to track events and produce data over time. And at the same time, and this is the paradox, to me this is a conflict that leaves many core critical questions unanswered, and I could tick off a number. What exactly is the Syrian army? How have the security services evolved over time? Through which vehicles do Syria and Iran actually exert influence over the Syrian regime? And what are the limitations of that influence? What, you know, which civilian state structures still function and why do they still function? What forms of decentralization de facto are underway? How does the aid economy tie into the war economy, and so on and so forth. There's a long list of questions which we're only beginning, I think, to address 5 years into this conflict through a conference like this one, and that strikes me as paradoxical. So I think both of these paradoxes I mentioned speak to the same challenge posed by this conference, which is to reach down to the granular level and enter that space where people, and Syrians in particular, are doing things for themselves, and then pull out and rebuild your analysis and your programs on that basis. So I'll focus specifically on the foreign donor Syrian implementing partner conundrum. And of course, Syria presents a number of challenges. I think it's been a uniquely challenging environment because of the extreme levels and forms of violence. Needs on the part of Syrians have been just as extreme. Anybody trying to intervene faces a dizzyingly volatile set of dynamics on the ground. It's an ever-shifting conflict. So at a macro level, it's very much an evolving stalemate and rather boring to tell as a story, but at the micro level, it's endlessly in movement. In that context, you have very severe information gaps, which have been compounded by the lack of direct access to most parts of the country, and a very rapid turnover on the part of Syrians who could produce quality insight at that level. And so meanwhile, the international community, donors, grant makers, have had to deal with an emerging civil society in Syria, which is still in need of professionalization, of cohesion, and of a better understanding of international standards. For now, it's still very cliquish, competitive, unsettled, in some cases very much ego-driven. In any other cases, so afraid of letting the egos speak, that there's a taboo about individual leadership on the part of within Syrian NGOs and civil society initiatives, leading to very cumbersome decision-making processes that don't help either. And at the grassroots level, at the most granular level, you have a kind of maze-like proliferation of very interesting initiatives, but typically extremely informal and fleeting, that create, I think, a lot of confusion as to how exactly money should trickle down. So there is a realization that effective relief work in a context like Syria, like anywhere else, rests on egalitarian partnerships with a very strong, predominant even, local component. But in practice, in Syria, the trend is massification. We see INGOs, international NGOs, UN agencies playing an ever bigger role, and then subcontracting to a whole chain of subcontractors, with Syrians very much at the bottom, massive expenditure towards the top and the middle, and the funds, in fact, over time moving higher up the ladder rather than trickling down. So if we unpack the reasons for that, I could suggest a number. One is that the greater the needs, the greater the volume of aid, the larger and the longer the grants, calling for ever more sophistication in the part of those who sign them. Then you have the externalization of bureaucratic processes on the part of grant makers who have become increasingly bureaucratic to the point of not being able to manage their own levels of bureaucracy and subcontracting that too, calling there again for high levels of sophistication on the parts of recipients. And the bigger the projects, the more derivative services you have. There's a whole industry of monitoring and evaluation and reporting and whatnot that has developed around this massification of aid towards the top of the chain. And then I think there's a reasonable natural inclination on the part of many donors, especially as resources grow scarce, to re-inject those resources to benefit their own national, international NGOs rather than foreign recipients. And I think there's likely a political component too, in the sense that, and although that's tacit, many of the grant makers are gradually giving up on the notion of empowering society and seeking other solutions, in a sense to contain the crisis, regardless of what that entails when it comes to such forms of empowerment. I think another set of explanations are to be found in the nature of this relationship between international donors and local recipients, Syrian recipients in this case. There's a deep lack of trust. International donors and players are seen as profiteering and ineffectual by many Syrians involved, whereas Syrian players are viewed as unprofessional and unreliable. And this creates a vicious circle in which international organizations establish ever more stringent procedures to impose transparency and accountability, but procedures that go beyond the capacity of most potential Syrian recipients to actually fulfill, creating an obsession with reporting and accountability and monitoring and evaluation and all kinds of concepts which are, you know, extremely difficult to grasp even for someone like me, relatively accustomed to them, and creating more inefficiency and adding to the distrust. Of course, creating additional costs also. I think we're seeing really an expansion of the inefficiencies in a financial definition of the word. And so all this reinforces the prejudices and the frustrations on both sides. The communication problem, I think, runs very deep. What we've witnessed through some preliminary field work, in fact, at Synapse on this issue, is that information coming from the ground, coming from that granular level, which is so relevant, I think, to actually making a difference in people's lives, doesn't trickle up effectively, not least because of this obsessing with reporting, which is another paradox, right? Many of the implementing partners are so fearful that budgets will be cut, that priorities will change, that they engage in a lot of retention of information that could potentially harm their activities. And this is very banal. I mean, to go back to the US, during the US occupation in Iraq, many of the troops on the ground at the granular level would lie to their hierarchy because people want to present a better picture than what they see, cover up for many mistakes they're making. But in this case, I think that the lack of trust plays a critical role. And all the more so that grant makers, international partners for these local NGOs and civil society initiatives come across as both extremely demanding and remarkably flippant. Priorities never seem to align with the needs on the ground. It takes typically a year for programming to adjust to what's actually happening in the field. And in fact, there are vested interests in not adjusting, and all the more so that the programs get bigger because it's costly to adjust. And large programs provide very little flexibility. And then you have all the fashions trending, you know, donors, grant makers jumping from one fancy and ill-defined concept to the next. And in some cases, with, I think, real political implications. Concept like stabilization, for instance, which has become widespread, or neutrality, to me is hard to comprehend in a conflict of this scale, of this viciousness. I mean, what does stabilization mean as the conflict still escalates? How can we impose neutrality as a fundamental criteria for making grants when society is this polarized, when such forms and levels of violence have been carried out, you know, to different degrees by both sides. So I'll identify in this presentation four major problems. The first one is that transparency and accountability doesn't seem to apply at the top of this chain as it does at the bottom. Right? The flow of money makes for a very asymmetric relationship. And I think it's interesting to think more about how grant makers, donors could themselves be transparent and accountable. If only to restore the level of trust which is needed to be efficient. The second problem is that those on the ground who are in the best position to understand the needs and who are actually doing the work, right, have virtually no capacity to shape priorities in a dynamic that is essentially donor-driven and, as a result, frustrating to all. I mean, I'm not trying to blame pin the blame on anyone in particular in this malfunctioning relationship. I think all stakeholders have an interest in thinking more about how to make it work better. And so we have this top-heavy system, and that's the third problem I wanted to raise, that constantly refers to empowerment and capacity building and resilience, but isn't geared at all towards cultivating what is, in my view, critically important in those respects. Access and insight into the groundswell of organic initiatives that are really essential to making life sustainable on the ground in many parts of Syria to this day, and will continue to be essential as the conflict endures and as Syria turns into, sadly, a form of failed state. And of course, informal networks, which are central to any form of problem solving in a context like Syria. The fourth and last problem I wanted to raise is that the very notion of helping Syrians has become toxic in the eyes of many Syrians, and this is an idea borrowed from Khadr Khadour, one of the co-organizers of this conference. We've been making endless statements, and it's going on and on and on as a consequence of Aleppo, expressing sympathy and heartbreak and God knows what in response to this crisis. But the aid regime and the development sector, if we're impotent politically or militarily, are the best, the most effective means we have to actually make that goodwill real and tangible to people subjected to extraordinary forms of suffering on the ground. So that last point I wanted to make, the last problem I wanted to address before wrapping up, is the need to mend the broken relationship between Syrians and the rest of the world, which I believe is as important as mending the broken relationship between Syrians themselves. And so there's no cause to wait. I've seen a lot of waiting for Godot over the past 5 years, a lot of expecting a corner to be turned, you know, with this or that, you know, the regime collapsing, or today, you know, the defeat of the opposition in Aleppo, which will somehow, you know, resolve this. It's you know, we're facing a vicious conflict that won't be resolved in years, however you look at it. And I think, you know, the notion that just engaging the regime provides solutions is naive. Engaging the regime will create another set of problems, although, you know, it might be inevitable for some. And so many have been behaving as if this was a botched conflict. You know, we didn't do it right. We got this one wrong. We'll draw lessons for next time around. And that to me is outrageous because, as I said, it's far from over. You know, years to go, and it's more importantly, it's the conflict of the age. Syria is important, has it knock-on effects in so many ways. It's interesting to see Syria become an issue in U.S. presidential elections, which traditionally have always been very inward-looking and focused on domestic issues. So, you know, Syria is already redefining humanitarian action, whether you want it or not. And we might as well engage with that and start experimenting with potential solutions as of now. So I think, I mean, that's a point I've made in some of my publications and which I wanted to restate as a to end on a more positive note. I think we've bypassed a lot of what there was or what there is to work with in the Syrian context, which you could sum up as Syrian agency. You know, this is an incredibly entrepreneurial, hands-on kind of society. We've seen impressive forms of solidarity, certainly within the confines of social networks. Syrians have a fluid and multifaceted identity. It doesn't boil down to sectarianism. They're extremely proud in their independence. They have we see very deep, resilient popular cultures, an natural inclination towards education, very highly pragmatic strands of religious conservatism, and so on and so forth. So I think that, you know, the particular facets of Syrian society, which would have provided some clues towards offering help, have largely been ignored. And if you look at it, Syrians have been incredibly innovative in every aspect of the conflict, from challenging the regime to documenting and surviving its repression, to filling the voids left by its partial retreat, to preserving some core elements of their identity in impossible circumstances, to navigating the economy of war, managing their forced mobility through their, again, innovative, desperate emigration, and so on and so forth. And one, One aspect which I found particularly interesting and full of potential is that the more educated stratum has produced a host of NGOs and civil society organizations, which have been interacting quite constructively, in fact, with field-based networks and initiatives on one side, and have been serving as an interface with the rest of the world on the other. And that linkage between what is de facto networks emanating from the bourgeoisie now in exile, and networks on the ground which are rooted in a much more popular, downtrodden component of Syrian society, that linkage is very, very strong, unusually strong. It's something we don't see in a country like Lebanon, for instance, and something to build on. And these educated Syrians who've moved abroad but still remain engaged and have developed all kinds of initiatives have been, although they might not be as sophisticated, professional, cohesive as donors would like them to be, but they have been on a very steep learning curve. And we're seeing 5 years into this conflict, a relatively mature, in fact, ecosystem of Syrian initiatives, which I think provides a real basis for more effective engagement. So my last word is to say that I do believe that putting Syrians back at the heart of any recovery process is key, and that there is no shortage of talent in that respect. I think this conference will have provided some supporting evidence of that, and Malik will do too if he ever shows up. Thank you.
I think it's the great absence. I thought he just walked in. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Noah, for very interesting insights. I'm going to just start with a quick question, and then we can open it to the floor. And the question is basically to Peter. A lot of the challenges that you described in a factual world are very much about, the challenges you describe within the aid architecture are very common to the aid architecture itself and not particular to, I think they're much more amplified in the Syrian context because the consequences, both in terms of size, but also because the consequences are much more serious. So I would perhaps ask you to highlight the ways in which aid has impacted local agency, the localization process, which is a bit of the discussion that has been happening in the conference. We talked a lot about local councils, alternate forms of organizing on the ground. I totally agree with you that the networks that have emerged are absolutely remarkable. There's tremendous work being done by civil society organizations. Some that were set up by external funding, and there he is. So if you could just talk a little bit about this. But before you do, I'm going to give the floor to Malik to perhaps comment a little bit about the opposition and the regional backers. Opposition and regional backers.
So this is working?
This is okay. Working.
First of all, apologies for coming late. I have a very good excuse. Maha knows. So.
Emergency meeting.
Yeah. my initial thoughts about the issue of localism, regionalism in Syria is that it has always been a feature of political life, has always informed the policies of the Syrian state since it was established 1946 or became independent 1946 and before. And what's interesting is that the first Syrian revolution, 1925, the Great Syrian Revolution, was a very, it's a regional revolution in the sense that, yes, there was an uprising against the French, but in Daraa, it took a particular form and had a particular leadership. In Damascus, Ghouta, it was the same thing. Ibrahim Hanano in Halab, same thing also. In Jabal Druze, for example, in the south also. So everywhere it took a different leadership. So it's in a way, what's happening now is really the kind of revolution that's happening now is very much like what happened back in those days. Not much has changed in the structure of Syrian society. Nicholas Van Damme, the former Dutch diplomat, I think he's recently retired, although he keeps coming back from retirement. He wrote a seminal work about regionalism, tribalism, and sectarianism in Syria. And it's a very apt title for his book, because those are the issues that really that animate people politically in Syria. And the regime, in many ways, is a product of these regional, tribal, sectarian divisions within Syrian society, or within the peoples that live within the country known as Syria. And the regime has quite effectively exploited the localism, regionalism, tribalism to cement its power in a sort of a divide and rule kind of way over several decades. So it's no surprise that when 2011 happened, people saw opportunity for rebellion against the regime, that this rebellion also took on a very sort of fragmented local, regional flavor. This is very much in keeping with the nature of Syrian society. And in many ways, you know, you can argue that the revolution isn't one revolution. It's a series of revolutions happening in various places that have distinct leadership and nature, unified by, I would say, two things. One is deep dislike of the Mukhabarat, the secret police state, because this secret police state taxed these people. That's one. And the other is also a dislike of the command economy, socialist economic model, which they believe has deprived them of their rightful slice of the cake in Syria. So whenever there was an uprising in any place like Daraa initially and spread to elsewhere, people tended to do two things. First of all, attack the local security branch, burn it down or blow it up. Another thing is to take over the state-owned enterprises, be it grain silos, bakeries, oil in the east, for example, and essentially privatize it. So what happened, uprising can be seen in some ways as local actors privatizing the state for their own interests. And this is what's actually happened and what I witnessed when I go into Syria. This is what I see. To what extent does this link to a national agenda for change? It doesn't. You know, and this is the problem of the opposition. The problem of the opposition is that the people actually rebelling against the regime, actually attacking the regime, dying in fights against the regime, are animated by things that are disconnected from what the Syrian Opposition Coalition or the Syrian National Council, as in the beginning, then it became the SOC, now the HNC, and so on. They're animated by different things to what those people are saying and demanding. And this links into the regional issue, because even though the local commanders of this uprising come from different backgrounds, generally speaking, rural, not particularly well off, I would say lower rural middle class, if you like, with a bit of education, not too much, those people are leading the uprising on the ground, and their motivations are local. The regional countries came along and said, okay, we're going to have a national political leadership for this uprising. Initially, Syrian National Council, then Syrian Opposition Coalition, and then the Higher Negotiation Committee, and so on. The problem is the people who controlled the SNC and the SOC, what they wanted was for them to be parachuted into Damascus and take over power, but essentially keep the state as it is. They didn't want to destroy it. They didn't want to, you know, they wanted the state as it is, but them to be in power. And this is what the regional countries wanted. The people on the ground who are rebelling against the regime wanted to fundamentally change the state. They wanted to grab as much economic power from the state. They wanted to dismantle the state. And in fact, they don't want the state back. They don't want the government back in those areas. They want to continue to be in charge. So this is why the Syrian opposition outside and the guys on the inside, they've had a lot of problems trying to see eye to eye. Not just this, but there's also a degree of animosity between the two. The Syrian opposition, the politicians, if you like, promoted, they look down on these guys in the same way as the regime looks down on the the rebels. They see them as riffraffs, you know, ru'a', as they say in Arabic. The Syrian opposition views them in the same way because they have, in many ways, their vision towards the state and towards the way that the country should be run is fundamentally not that different to that of the regime. I'll stop there.
I wanted to ask you if you could talk a little bit also about the role of external actors and the regional backers mainly.
Okay. Well, the regional backers, the big mistake, in my opinion, that the regional backers made is that they empowered local rebel commanders. But they empowered them and they remained local. For example, Jamal Ma'rouf in Idlib, for example, the Saudis supported him heavily, but he just remained an Idlib-based leader. He never emerged to become a national leader. Similarly, in Ghouta, Zahran Alloush, he was supported by Saudi Arabia and then later by Qatar, but he never emerged to be a national leader. This is the big mistake the regional countries made, which is that they never helped promote one leader from within the uprising on the ground to become the national leader. Instead, what they tried to do is rely on the opposition outside to offer that national leadership. Now, of course, I think that pioneers, you might say, of regionalism and localism in Syria within the Syrian revolutionary context is Jordan. Because they were the first to realize, well, very early on, they made a very astute judgment. And this is what they would tell people. They would say, if we have an inkling of even 1% that this regime is going to survive, we're not going to support you fully because it could backfire on us. And they had bad experience from the 1980s when they supported the Brotherhood and the diplomats ended up getting killed around the world. So they realized that we need to think locally, we need to think regionally. So the Southern Front project was created. And the Southern Front is essentially a Dara-focused project, the aim of which is to freeze the conflict in Dara and isolate Dara from the rest of whatever's happening in the rest of the country. And by and large, it has worked. It has worked because the rebels in Dara have not lost significant territory to the regime in the last 12 months. They've kept what they have, they kept the weapons, they continue to train, they continue to defend themselves if they're attacked. Unlike what happened, for example, in Aleppo, where they continue to lose. So they haven't, the regional backers, Jordan was smart enough to realize that as soon as Russia entered the war, really it was game over for the opposition. So best things we can do is to freeze the conflict and keep our stake by promoting localism in Daraa. Right now, I spoke to some commanders from Daraa, and some of them, and there's a large feeling in Daraa which says that actually, why don't we just join Jordan? Why don't we become part of Jordan somehow? And that's it. Now, of course, it sounds fanciful that would ever happen. But they are so reliant on Jordan now that they might as well just be part of an extension of Jordan. And I think ultimately this is what Jordan wants. And ultimately this is what Turkey finally stumbled upon, which is let's do the same thing in the north. So under the guise of fighting ISIS, they created the Euphrates Shield. They've carved their own southern front type area in the north. And ultimately, I think what will happen is there will be significant territories in Syria that are bound up in deals, such as the Four Towns deal, or where countries have a direct investment in, like Turkey in the Euphrates Shield or Jordan in the south, that the regime, yes, will continue to rule Damascus, but its hands will be tied, as it were. And the idea that we can go back to full Syrian sovereignty, I think, is a myth. And I think in the long term, this would lead to the eventual collapse of the regime, in the long term. Because Syria will become like a Swiss cheese. This area, that's Turkey. If you want to do anything here, you've got to speak to guys in Ankara. Here, you've got to speak to Amman. Here, you've got to speak to Tehran. Like, I'm from Madaya, for example. Madaya is now part of the Four Towns deal. Zabadani, Madaya, Fua, Kifriya. If I want to get my elderly aunt to get treatment in Damascus or Lebanon, I speak to the Iranian. I don't speak to the regime. Because it's the Iranian that gives permission to the guy on the checkpoint to say, yes, let this woman pass. So there will be enough of these deals, I think, in the next year or so, that it will be very hard for the regime to claim full sovereignty. Slowly, slowly, its control over the country will begin to crumble, but it will take a long time. And it will depend on opposition, how clever they are in exploiting these local deals, local dynamics, to keep eating away at the regime's legitimacy.
Very bleak picture. Hold on, please. Sorry. Let's just. We're. Do you want to say anything about the Golan Front?
The Golan Front. There are three actors, three countries that are invested in Golan: Jordan, Israel, and the UAE. And you know, you have a local commander called Abu Usama al-Julani, who is on very good terms with. He's supported by the UAE. He's on very good terms with the Jordanians and indirectly with the Israelis also. So you have a Jesh Lahad, South Lebanon army type situation, not exactly, but you have enough armed men who are not part of the regime to border that, to control that, that control that border area. So ultimately everyone is happy, except maybe Bashar al-Assad.
Thank you, Malik. Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Noah. Given that we don't have a lot of time left, I'm going to open it up for questions. Mona? Just can you hold for microphone?
Hi, my name is Mona Alami. I'm a non-resident fellow with the Atlantic Council. My question is actually to Malik. You've spoken about Turkey and about Jordan, but you haven't spoken about the Saudi role, the Saudi backing for to the opposition, and if there is a shift, noticeable shift on Saudi priorities in Syria.
I think the role of Saudi Arabia is often misunderstood. A lot of people blame everything on Saudi Arabia. Oh, what's happening? It's Saudi's fault because no one likes the Wahhabis, so they're an easy target to attack. In reality, Saudi Arabia has not been particularly proactive in Syria in the last 12 months, I would say. And this is causing frustration among its own allies, Qatar and Turkey, who do want Saudi Arabia to play a more active role. Problem with the Saudi is that they have there's sort of three threats that are much more direct to Saudi national security than Syria. And those are the situation in Yemen, where you have Saudi cities being rocketed, and this is a direct attack on the legitimacy of the Al Saud, who the whole idea is that they have unified the Arabian Peninsula and defended it against, you know. So to be attacked by Yemenis is not good. The other issue is ISIS and the threat within the kingdom itself from ISIS cells and so on. And especially Saudis who have joined ISIS in Iraq or Syria and potentially could come back and start problems in Saudi. And the third, I forgot what the third issue is.
Internal.
Well, yeah, I mean, you got the economic situation where the state is finding it challenging to pay public salaries, to pay pay companies to carry out large infrastructure projects and things like this. So Saudi Arabia has its own challenges. Syria, yes, symbolically, as far as the Saudi public opinion is concerned, is an issue. But when it comes down to it, it's not the number one or number two or even number three issue for Saudi Arabia. And also Saudi Arabia is finding it challenging in terms of making its influence, projecting influence in Syria, because they tried in the south through the Southern Front, and they funded the Southern Front heavily, and they lost control of the Southern Front because other actors basically muscled in, and they were able to get the ear of the Jordanians, who convinced them that they should proceed in a different direction to the one that Saudi wanted. So they have limited options. In the north, it's Turkey calling the shots. The only possible area where I can see them having influence is the eastern region, Deir ez-Zor, Badia, that kind of area. But even then, with the presence of Russia, with possibly the Hashd al-Sha'bi, PMFs coming in from Iraq to attack ISIS in Deir ez-Zor, it's going to be difficult for them too. So it's a crowded space.
In the back, then.
My question is to Malik. I'm Joël from Oxfam. You painted a bit of a rosy picture on the Southern Front, where there's a sort of a stabilization now. And there are about 80,000 civilians stuck at the border between Jordan and Syria. What do you think is going to happen to them? And do you think they could be a threat to the sort of status quo that we see there now?
My name is Elias Farhat. A question to Mr. Nouah. You mentioned joint operation center in which the United States is represented. Where is this operation center and what forces does it lead?
My name is Samir Al-Khoury. you mentioned that the Syrians are playing a big role in the activities taking place in the country now. However, nobody mentioned when will the refugees be able to return, and will they be able to return to their own regions, or is there some ethnic cleansing taking place within Syria which will prevent them from going back to their properties and regions? Thank you.
Thank you. There's one more, the gentleman there.
Thank you. My name is Yahya Hakim. Regarding refugees today, everybody talks about refugees outside of Syria, but nobody talks about the refugees inside Syria, like in the Damascus area and the Ladiyeh area. So this is something that is a little bit foggy. Another thing is that you talked about actors like Turkey, Jordan, but Qatar, for instance, France, for instance, especially France, since 2005 was always vehement about the Syrian regime. And now, if you listen to what they are talking about, they are the ones who are leading all the offensive against the Syrian regime in the Security Council. So all these actors are international actors that are not, are still, this role is foggy. Could you please explain that?
One question to this, to any of you who wants to answer, which is the role of Egypt. I mean, there were some news reports recently that Egypt is sending troops, but has already has some of its key people in the army in Syria. What do you make of this? Shall we start with Noah maybe, and then move to Peter and then Malik?
Sure, so I'll take the question on the joint operations room. So I mentioned, I used two acronyms, MOC and MUM. Without getting into what they stand for, these are the two joint operations room run. The operations rooms run jointly by the state backers of the armed opposition. The MOC is in the south. This is what Malik was referring to in detail. It backs the Southern Front, and it's the component factions of what's often referred to as the Southern Front, what's officially known as the Southern Front. Jordan, as Malik was illustrating, is by far the most influential actor within the MOC, because at the end of the day, it controls the border, and its intelligence agency is most directly involved in managing relations with the armed groups and their supply lines. The U.S., the UAE, Saudi, have generally been very involved in the MOC, and the other opposition state backers to a lesser extent. The MUM is the operations room in Turkey, and it's what I just said about Jordan, about the MOC, applies to Turkey with the MUM. It has the most influence among over the factions themselves, and the role of the other actors is secondary, I would say. The U.S. was instrumental in creating these operations rooms, and its role has been important. It's played an organizing role and a vetting role. Organizing in that U.S. investment has helped promote these two operations rooms as primary channels for material support going to armed groups. They're not the only channels, especially in the north, but they've become the primary ones. U.S. investment helped encourage the opposition's regional backers to shift their own supports in that manner. And the U.S. has played a primary role in deciding who gets what support in the vetting process. And it's played a limiting role in constraining, in putting limits on what the other regional backers are willing and able to give. And that's most famously with regard to MANPADs. The sophisticated MANPADs in general have not have not been provided in any meaningful fashion. And that's basically, at the end of the day, that's the result of a U.S. position pressuring the opposition's regional backers not to. The U.S. is also, the U.S. alternatively has been very involved in supplying anti-tank weapons, which go, again, exclusively to these vetted groups. So in the south, over time, to make a long story short, the MOC became really, its influence became dominant over the armed opposition in the south. But in the north, for various reasons, the MUM never quite got to the same level, in part because of the existence of alternative means of acquiring support and of generating local revenue, et cetera, all of which has been, you know, the field has been more open for that in the north, shall we say.
Peter?
I forget what your question was, but it was very interesting. On local councils, to me, the point which Malik made about the conflict dynamics empowering the emergence of local elites who have a stake in the outcomes and have to be taken seriously, also connects with what I was describing about the aid regime, which is another vehicle for the production of potential elites. And so what I always found bizarre was the belief that in areas where the regime had retreated, the UK and others could support nascent structures that would, in essence, build the state from the bottom up. I don't think a state is ever built from the bottom up, but, although I'm a great believer in bottom-up dynamics, nonetheless. I mean, all the more so that the regime's policy of disruption was always to make sure that such a dynamic would not be possible. But what's interesting is really the incubation of new figures within opposition armed groups, within local NGOs, or even initiatives supported by outside players. And the outcomes of such incubation are not foretold. An interesting example is that many of the more effective founders of Syrian NGOs now in exile belong to the Syrian bourgeoisie, actually acquired a number of skills within Asma al-Assad's Syria Trust. And very early on in the uprising, flipped and joined the opposition and have been using those skills in ways which she certainly wouldn't have foreseen. So I actually think that we don't pay sufficient attention to this notion of incubation, which we should follow with a very open mind, because it's unclear where it will go. Just on Saudi Arabia, I think one, I mean, I go a lot to Saudi Arabia myself, and to me they've always lacked the institutional capacity required to leverage whatever money they have on the ground. Money is far from enough, so they've picked the occasional front head figure whom they hope to empower, but without diving into the nitty-gritty of this conflict, I think there's very little one can achieve. And I think that's the dilemma that many Western governments, France, the US, and others have faced. They want to contain this conflict while staying out of it to the extent possible. And I find that the players who are more effective in producing the outcomes they desire are those who go all in. And not necessarily with a view to escalate, but Iran, Russia, and today I think Turkey are going all in, and we'll see where that goes. Many others, like Egypt, just project fantasies onto this conflict, which are mostly irrelevant to its dynamics, or they seek distractions from problems at home. So we've seen a lot of that, but I think it's largely inconsequential. And then I like the question on when will the refugees return, which poses another question, which is what does a regime victory look like? And I think Malik offered one possible scenario. I think none of the scenarios we can think of today point to recovery and stabilization. And certainly none of them point to a situation where you wouldn't have to make the effort of going down into the nitty-gritty to intervene, even if it's in the context of aid and development. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter.
So quickly, rosy picture of the Southern Front. I don't think I am painting a rose picture. I think the Southern Front is what it is. They've been, in the last year, they've been not doing very much. Their salaries come on and off, depending. But basically, the Southern Front, Daraa, used to be an active front line that's no longer active, largely because of the interference of a neighboring country, Jordan, which has deactivated this front line. It hasn't resolved the problem of people there. There's still criminality, there's, you know, law and order issues. But at least not many people are being killed there. The refugees on the Jordan-Syrian border, actually it's a lot more. In Rukban refugee camp, for example, there's almost 70,000. And this is a camp inside Syria, but it's right on the border with Jordan. So obviously Jordan feels that it cannot take any more Syrians. And that's partly why they decided to deactivate the front line in the south, because they don't want more refugees. Now, of course, linked to the issue of refugees and ITPs is the issue of reconstruction. Because I think that if and when reconstruction happens, and the EU have already begun talking about potential reconstruction money if there's a transition, if that ever happens. But I think the issue of reconstruction is going to be very problematic in Syria, because some areas are going to get a lot of money and some areas aren't going to get any money at all. So, for example, if you're from Rif Dimashq, Douma, if you're Halab, Homs, yes, your house has been destroyed, you want a new house. So there's going to be billions of dollars poured into some areas. And the areas where most of the people come from who have fought and died for the regime aren't going to get anything, because the areas are not damaged. The infrastructure is still what it is. So I think there's going to be a lot of problems internally over how this money is spent and where it's going to go and who's going to spend it and who decides to spend it, who gets the contracts. That issue is going to be huge, and it's going to create a lot of local and regional problems. For example, take Homs. You have some neighborhoods in Homs completely destroyed. These are majority Sunni neighborhoods. Billions of dollars are going to go in to reconstruct that area. What about people who live in majority Alawi districts? Aren't they going to get that money? They would want to refurbish their house as well, or build a new, I don't know, stadium or something. So there's going to be problems on the issue of this. The issue of France. Yes, President Chirac was anti-Assad, and he led the way in imposing sanctions and so on. But then President Sarkozy came and he welcomed Bashar back in that famous parade, military parade, and that was the beginning of the rehabilitation of Bashar. I think the same thing might happen again. Hollande leading the charge against Assad, possibly the next president will welcome him back. So the issue of France, I don't think France is like necessarily anti-Assad as a sort of establishment, depending on who's running the Elysee Palace.
With this, I want to thank our panelists and thank the audience for staying with us and being patient with us. Thank you.